Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning, everyone. So we are going live now. It is my distinguished pleasure to welcome you all to the Virtual Law School. And today, from the Virtual Law School, where we started our journey on April 25th with the inauguration, and from April 27th, where we started our classes. My dear friends, I'm very happy to inform everyone that we have completed third successful week of classes, running 5 to 6 average classes a day on selected subjects like constitutional law, intellectual property law, ADR, interpretation of statutes, family law, and also one of the very, you know, interesting areas, law of evidence. So we have been conducting lectures for various law students from across the country, and there's been no distinction, no kind of differentiation at Virtual Law School that the student comes from a national law school or from a state leading private university or a government law school or any other law college of the country. On that note, we have also not been distinguishing whether the student has paid few thousands of rupees as the fee for the legal education or some lakhs of rupees. Because the idea was very simple, my dear friends, that that we started on a pro bono note as a virtual law school, where I have promoted this very idea that how we can collectively reduce the cost of legal education in the country. So that is the reason that today we have completed this journey for last almost over a month. And I was very blessed by some of my teachers, some of the professors from the legal academia who have come forward and supported. And here we have right before us on the screen, Professor Shanta Kumar, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Gujarat National Law University, who was one of the very first professors to support me in this movement of doing something new, trying to innovate, trying to do my bit of reforming legal education as a law teacher. Thank you for that, sir. You know, from the day of inauguration, and before that, when I began discussing with you about the virtual law school, you have always been very encouraging. And today it gives me pleasure, friends, to also introduce a new series of lectures for the virtual law school, which we are calling as GLAD Talk Series, which would mean Global Legal Approach and Developments, which will be discussed by distinguished scholars of law and also other disciplines at Virtual Law School. And I think that this could only be fitting to start the inaugural lecture by a well-accomplished legal academic like Professor Shanta Kumar, who has not only been supporting us through our journey, but has also contributed long years to legal academia in India. Professor Shanta Kumar has been teaching for over 27 years. Sir has also taught in prestigious Hidayatullah National University in Raipur, and has been alumni of Madras University for LLB, post-graduation and PhD. And I must surprise everyone in the audience, Professor Shanta Kumar has a very distinguished combination of having practiced at the bar in Madras High Court and other district courts in Madras, and then being a well-accomplished law teacher, which is a very rare combination among the legal academic to blend the law practice and also going a full-time law teachers. Most of us are the law teachers, and we might not have had the background of substantial years of practicing at the bar. And then it gives me a very, sense of happiness to also tell you all, when I was growing up, when I was doing my law, one of the first books on environment law that I studied was the book authored by Professor Shanta Kumar, which is also dedicated to my common law my teacher, who has been also a well-wisher and teacher of Professor Shanta Kumar, Professor M.K. Ramesh from National Law School, Bangalore. So he's been a distinguished scholar of environmental law, and sir has now, been doing a lot of commendable work on environment law, and because of which sir's work was recognized by Asian Development Bank, which conferred on Professor Shanta Kumar Environmental Law Champions Development Award from Philippines. And at the same time, sir has authored, books on environment law, human rights, constitutional law, international law have been areas of sir's expertise in teaching. So on that note, I must tell everybody, as you all would have seen the flyers and the posters so far, that today's lecture is on a very special subject matter. As we recently saw, that there's been a gas leak issue in Vizag. This is something which has not been probably happening for the first time in the country. This has been a very callous approach and of the state and the non-state entities together, I would say, as a legal academic. And Sir is today going to trace that, have we learned some lessons from Bhopal to Vizag till date? What has been the assessment of environmental law and policy in that regard? And that is going to, you know, give us a very good perspective that where do we stand as the country today in terms of law and policy setup, and also for the scholars of environmental law to understand that how should they try to think of their research in this particular realm further. Probably Sir can guide you through that, how far it's going, that you need to come down to the ground realities and also try to check up with the empirical research, not merely doctrinal, in terms of these kinds of, you know, fields which where you may definitely need to go and talk to different stakeholders, including the affected parties. So on that note, I welcome you, sir, and welcome so everyone in the audience. I have muted everyone. At the end of the session, you all will be able to ask questions from sir, and we have a time limit, so sir has to proceed for a meeting at 11:30. Hence, please keep your questions very brief at the end. So over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nachiketa Mittal. My sincere appreciations to you for creating such a wonderful platform and providing an opportunity for all these young law students from all over the country, which otherwise they would not have got an exposure or an opportunity to interact with the kind of speakers whom you bring on your platform. So my special appreciations to you and my best wishes that a virtual law school should do a lot of good things which the brick and mortar law schools could not do. And I wish that the law students in this country will be really fortunate enough to take advantage of the school that you have created online, and the kind of opportunities, the kind of speakers, the kind of lectures that you are organizing. I'm sure that it's going to immensely benefit the legal academic community, not only the law students, but also the teachers who can listen to the lectures, like lectures from very eminent speakers whom you have been bringing. I have been following you for quite some time, and I'm quite impressed, and I'm sure that you are really going to create a mark and create an impact in the quality of legal education that what this country is offering. So with that note, let me get into the subject. I thought that being an environmental law teacher, I think I should take up this issue which happened last week in Vishakhapatnam, Vizag, where there was a leak of a gas called styrene from the LG polystyrene company at Vishakhapatnam. I know that there will be many young scholars here who will be listening to this lecture. So I thought that directly, instead of talking about the LG styrene leak case, I felt that it is very, very important for a law teacher to take them to the world's largest industrial disaster, the catastrophe which happened in India at Bhopal in 1984. Many of the participants today might not have been born during those days in 1984. It's now 36 years. But then I thought that deliberately to connect this incident with that incident, and therefore to see that as a student of law, how these disasters are going to teach us the lessons what this country need to learn. Now, let me start with Vizag, and then I will go to Bhopal, and then I'll touch upon here and there certain other gas leak incidents as well. And then I'll trace the evolution of environmental law and other major principles which is protecting the environment today, what we have in this country. Last week, it was precisely 7th of May, we could see. I hope everybody must have seen a lot of videos circulating on social media and WhatsApp, Facebook, where there were images of people literally collapsing for no reasons, and they were not aware. Originally, we thought that maybe somebody affected or the final stages of COVID-19 cases. But then I could realize that this is because of inhaling styrene in large amounts, which gas leaked from LG styrene company, which at Visakhapatnam. Now, good that immediately everybody sprung to action, though this incident left 12 people killed immediately, almost 5,000 of them evacuated under these lockdown circumstances. Because these circumstances are very important. It's not 5,000 people running away from a place is not important, but especially during lockdown when we are following social distancing and all other safety precautions against COVID-19. 5,000 of them getting evacuated from one place. You could have seen those videos. I wish people should Google and find those videos, how people were evacuated from that place. More than 1,000 of them have been partially or permanently, totally injured, disabled because of this incident. I'm happy that the NGT immediately took a Suomoto cognizance of this particular incident, and immediately it said on 7th itself, it said that tomorrow we are going to pass orders. So on 8th May, immediately the very next day, NGT came out with an order awarding an interim directing the company LG Polystyrene to provide 50 crores immediately to the district collector to take care of the relief operations to help those victims. The chief minister of Andhra Pradesh, along with his team of officers from the State Pollution Control Board, rushed to the spot. The chief minister himself tried to he visited the spot and assessed that situation, and along with officers, and then and there he notified that all the family of those victims will be given compensation, and he was very gracious enough to award a 1 crore rupee compensation for those disease families. NGT also had constituted a committee under the chairmanship of a former judge of the Andhra Pradesh High Court to investigate this case, and parallelly, the state government had also constituted a committee to look into it. And once this news started, interesting facts are coming up. An industry of such magnitude, I could not believe, has been running in this country for so many years without an environmental clearance. This was really shocking. How could such a big industry dealing with hazardous substances can function without an environmental clearance from the central government? But then again, there are technical arguments going on that because they say that they got the consent from the State Pollution Control Board, therefore they're operating. But this is totally in ignorance of the requirement of environmental clearance, which they ought to have obtained, which they must obtain before commencing their operations. But it's an interesting fact which came out that they were operating since 2006 without an environmental clearance in this country. So this takes us to the lapses, what is happening, what all the technical reasons behind the leak of this gas. That I think we need to wait for some more time till these investigations are over, where we can find out the facts. But what I wanted to say today is that this is not something new that what we are witnessing today. That is where I thought that I will take you to the Bhopal incident and see that how we should relate this incident with that incident and see how we could learn from that incident. I know many of you must have studied in your environmental classes about this Bhopal gas leak disaster and the subsequent invocation of many legal doctrines which came because of this particular instance. Let me talk for a few minutes about the disaster itself and what led to the disaster. So this is, again, I do not really know till date, even after 36 years, on whom should we fix responsibility for what happened in Bhopal, which is considered to be the world's largest disaster even to date. Almost 6 lakh people have been the victim of this disaster. According to the, if I need to give a precise number, it is 5,74,000 who have been compensated. So that is the record that we have as for about the victims. But there might be people who have not reached the authorities for compensation. But at least the government record says that they have compensated 5,74,000 people who have been affected by this disaster. 5,74,000, you know, when the country is so, the entire country is has gone to lockdown to save the lives of thousands of people who are being killed by COVID-19. See the enormous amount of lives that we have lost. And what was the reasons? If you look at the reasons, it's not one factor. That is why I don't use the word accident here. It was not an accident. Bhopal was not an accident. The plant managers, the Union Carbide Corporation, was completely in knowledge of the series of incidences which were happening there. And what happened on 2nd December 1984, the Bhopal gas leak disaster, was not the first incident. Even according to the safety audit conducted by Union Carbide Corporation in 1982, 2 years before this incident, the safety auditors who conducted the safety audit at Bhopal had told that this is a very risky operation. It's a very dangerous operation, which has resulted in almost 61 accidents, out of which 31 were major, resulting in loss of life. And therefore, the safety auditors gave a cautionary note to the company that take all precautionary measures to ensure that such accidents don't reoccur. But still, it was a formality, so they had to conduct a safety audit. They conducted it and then they kept that file without doing anything. If you look at that particular day, you know, when on 2nd December, when 2nd December 1984, when this incident happened at Bhopal, same like here at Visakhapatnam, how LG started operation on 7th of May, after 44 days of lockdown. Similarly, on 2nd of December, Bhopal commences its operation after its annual maintenance, which was for almost 40 days. A lot of similarities. That is why I tried that. I thought I will try and link these two incidences. When they commence an operation after 40 days of closure of the industry, and why did they close it? For maintenance work. And what all they should have maintained? They should have maintained their equipments and ensured that all the safety devices, safety measures are in place. If you look at the Bhopal gas leak disaster, number one, the substance what they have used, methyl isocyanate. First of all, it was a prohibited substance. Most of the countries in the world have banned it. But India permitted the use of methyl isocyanate. I do not know whom do we blame for it. At any given point of time, no country will permit storage of more than 1 ton of methyl isocyanate in the production plant, in the industry. But on the day of incident, we had the tank which leaked had 42 tons of methyl isocyanate, almost 41 times more than what it was supposed to store. Later, they also had another ton with equal amount of methyl isocyanate. another 40 tons of methyl isocyanate in another one more tank, which had to be cleared by a team of 12 experts, which is again, I would, for further research, it's a very interesting episode. And in fact, these guys are real heroes who saved Bhopal from another major disaster. Please Google for Operation Faith. Operation Faith is another very interesting, you should see a few documentaries made on it. BBC had made a documentary on this, Operation Faith. National Geography Channel has made a documentary on this. That's a phenomenal work that our Indian scientists have done to diffuse the remaining 42 tons of methyl isocyanate, which is stored in the other tank, which did not explode. So coming back to this tank, which exploded. Number one, you are not supposed to store so much. You had stored it. The another condition for storing of methyl isocyanate is it should be kept under 4.5 degrees of temperature. That is the ideal temperature in which methyl isocyanate should be stored. But the refrigeration unit, which was supposed to keep the methyl isocyanate in that temperature, was on a standby mode that day. And actually, this chemical in 42 times more than the capacity was stored at 20 degrees plus temperature. It's a series of events. It's not one accident that somebody, like going by the Union Carbide theory, they say that it is a sabotage caused by an employee. Now, how can a sabotage, one employee can cause a sabotage in such a big industry if you have all safety devices in place? So that is where their argument did not hold good in any of the courts, and that is why they had to face the consequences, whatever they had to face. But whatever money that they have paid, how is it going to compensate the loss of lives, the loss of limbs and arms that people have lost in this incident? How is that money going to compensate? I don't know. So it was stored. Number two, there was no operation manual. Lack of information, lack of training of even the employees who were handling methyl isocyanate. In the entire country, there was only one person who was trained in handling methyl isocyanate. A factory which was working on three shifts, the trained guy was there in the morning shift who was not there in the night time. In fact, if he would have been there, he would have prevented that incident, because this incident itself was caused because of lack of awareness about the inherent nature of this chemical methyl isocyanate. This is a very, very important factor to understand Vizag case, the knowledge of this thing. How? It's not only the employees. If you look at, look into the history and if you connect all the dots of what happened, a resident doctor who was employed by the Union Carbide Corporation to give first aid to the employees, a lady, a doctor, she resigned from her job and she left, and she confessed before the BBC team which created that documentary, telling that I resigned from this place because I did not know what is this chemical is all about, what effect that it will cause for people inhaling it, and what is the antidote to be given to someone who had inhaled methyl isocyanate. And I have, in spite of asking the organization about all these details, I was not provided, and therefore I had to helplessly witness a person dying who had inhaled methyl isocyanate. Then I felt that I am working against my conscience, and therefore I had to leave that organization. Now let's come out to the community. No one, including the district magistrate, was aware what is this company was using it as a raw material and what is the antidote, because when the gas leaked, the district administration was not aware of what was this gas and what should be done to neutralize it. They were trying to contact NIRI at the middle of the night to find some information about this methyl isocyanate. when each and every second was important to save the life of people, they could not save the life effectively just for one reason, that they did not have the appropriate information to handle this incident. So they were knocking the doors of NIRI at the middle of the night to the NIRI, the scientific agency at Nagpur, the National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, to find out what exactly is this chemical and what will happen to the people. The doctors at Bhopal, the CMO, he was not aware of it. And he did not know what to do when people started rushing to the hospitals. He was perplexed. He did not know what to do. What is this chemical? You know, what will happen to people who are inhaling to it? What antidote to be given? If you look into the incident, you will see that because people were complaining that their eyes were burning, they were giving eye drops to all the patients who were coming to Bhopal. When they were administering eye drops to patients, people have started dying. So this is the lack of information, lack of knowledge incidences. And today, now we will have to relate it to Visakhapatnam and see that how many of the district administration or the common man or the medical officer around that industry know anything about style. What is this chemical is all about? What is the impact of this? The same thing. They were not sure of what to be given to the people who were exposed to styrene in Visakhapatnam. So the point that I want to try to make is that, you know, if you start connecting Bhopal with Vizag, you still see that we haven't learned the lessons. But interestingly, you will see that in United States of America, immediately when this incident happened in 1984, in 1986, they came out with a law to prevent such incidents happening in United States of America. They came out with a law called Emergency Planning and Right to Know Act or something like that. Please Google for that act. The United States, the US Congress immediately brought a legislation to prevent such occurrence in United States of America, but we did not come out with any law to prevent it. Whatever law we made was the Bhopal Act, which came immediately in 1985, was to empower the government of India to file a common suit, a civil suit against Union Carbide Corporation for filing the claim application before the courts. So it's not only about a lack of information. See, the industrial standards requires that when you deal with a hazardous substance like this, you need to have certain safety measures in hand. Union Carbide Corporation plant had all those safety measures, but none of them were operational on that particular day. It's not that day somebody had disabled all these things. Union Carbide did not maintain all those safety measures. For example, there is a flare tower. You must have seen, you know, whenever you go through hazardous industries, there will be a big, tall chimney. On top of that chimney, fire will be going on. Right? That's called flare tower. So any chemical which escapes will escape through that flare tower, and ultimately, before it leaks, it will be burnt. So it's a safety device envisioned and provided there. But you will see that if you read the reports of the Bhopal incident, you will read that the pipeline which was connecting this methyl isocyanate to the flare tower, that pipeline was removed. And they said that the company simply said that the pipeline got corroded and we have removed it for replacing it. But by then it got leaked. So the flare tower, though the flare tower was there, but it could not be functional because there was no connecting pipeline. There are other safety devices like gas scrubbers. For example, caustic soda was used in the gas scrubber, that whenever methyl isocyanate leaks, it mixes with caustic soda, which neutralizes. Therefore, there will be no side effects of methyl isocyanate. But unfortunately, out of so many gas scrubbers, only one gas scrubber was functioning, which was highly insufficient for 42 tons of methyl isocyanate. If they would have stored 1 ton of methyl isocyanate, it would have been possible. No, see, and all these things have been done by Union Carbide to cut their costs. So when it comes to industrial safety, when it comes to the lives of the common man, is cutting costs can be considered a right strategy by these industries. And unfortunately, there was only one factories inspector for the entire city of Bhopal, which had more than 250 such industries. So what do you expect this guy, poor guy, to go and inspect? So we do not have adequate number of people with capacity to inspect or to audit all these things. So it was a failure of the district administration, the governmental machinery at that particular point of time. So we did not provide the adequate manpower to see that these hazardous industries are functioning. For example, see this. Why I am emphasizing this point is, till date, nobody knew until this incident happened in Visakhapatnam that this industry did not have an environmental clearance. This is like, driving your car without an RC. Where, it's not keeping the RC at home and driving. You don't have an RC at all. So this is something, I can't imagine that how can, it's not a small industry, it's not a small cottage industry or a middle, it's a huge hazardous industry. How it had gone outside the notice of the administrators is something which is very, very important to note. All the safety measures failed in Bhopal, and which again resulted in a lot of other courtroom dramas. I do not know how many of you have done a study on this particular case. Please, any law student, especially studying law of tort, need to do a thorough research on this particular case, especially because it's a fantastic case study for any law student to see how the law works and how the law responds to a situation of this nature. So the government decided that let's not file the case in India. So the government thought that if we go to the US court, we will get more compensation. But then why will a district court in New York will assume jurisdiction over something what happened in Bhopal? So there comes a new doctrine, where the government came out with the Bhopal Gas Leak Disaster Claims Act, and under that act, government assumed the role of parens patriae. I think many of you must have read this doctrine of parens patriae, where the government assumed the role of a parent, and then it filed one common suit against on behalf of all victims in Bhopal. And it tried to confer jurisdiction on the district court, assuming that the US courts are very generous in granting compensation. They asked for a 3.3 billion compensation from the district court, but the district court, the judge, district judge Keenan, who decided this case, his reasoning, his judgment is phenomenal. I wish all of you need to read that judgment, especially the arguments made by it. And what I wanted to place before is one of the reasons why government said that they had come to New York is that they said that the law is the law in India is at its infancy. The courts have not handled in India a case of this magnitude, and therefore they also cited long delay involved in the justice system, and because of all these reasons, we don't want to try this matter in India, and therefore we want the New York court to assume jurisdiction in this case. In fact, the district judge Keenan was quite annoyed. He was surprised. How can a government talk so bad about its own courts in an affidavit filed before a foreign court? Right. But then he had to proceed based on the submissions made before it, and therefore what he did, he asked for some supporting evidences to say that Indian courts are not are incapable of handling such matters. There were two senior advocates. I don't want to take their name. There were two senior advocates who had given an affidavit before the district judge, supporting the arguments of the Union of India that, yes, the courts in India are incompetent to handle a matter of this magnitude, and therefore this court should assume jurisdiction. But after hearing all these things, so finally the district judge Keenan, he disposed this matter. So we had to come back to India after 3 years. So we have lost almost 2.5 years in this battle in New York, legal battle in New York. We came to India. Then government of India had to file it before the district and sessions court, district court at Bhopal. And interestingly, you will find that again, it took so many years for the Bhopal court to come out with a verdict here, because the first judge who heard this petition, he got elevated and he became the judge of the High Court. Another judge came. He started hearing this matter. In the middle of the hearing, it was alleged that his family members were also one of the claimants, because they were also aggrieved by this incident. So therefore, he had to recuse himself. The third judge who came to listen to this case, very unfortunate that he died in an accident. And fourth, the district judge who finally gave an order in this particular matter, district judge Diop. Please read this judgment. It is very, very unusual in this country, a district judge writing such a fantastic judgment. Those powers, whatever was used only by the Supreme Court, he used those powers under different provisions of Civil Procedure Code. For example, you all must have, students of constitutional law, you know, under Article 142, the Supreme Court can pass any orders to do complete justice. He invoked a similar power under Section 151 of the CPC. He says that I have inherent powers and I will pass any orders. And he also used Section 94 in association with the Section 151 of CPC to come out with a very interesting order. And why I said it's a very quite unusual judgment is because I have not seen a district judge quoting Lord Denning and the English courts in writing a judgment. He had relied upon a number of judgments given by the English courts in UK, and especially he had relied upon Lord Denning's judgment and his statements. And he So he awarded 350 crores of rupees as an interim compensation. He said that first pay 350 crores and as interim compensation to take care of the relief measures, and thereon we can decide this dispute. Union Carbide was aggrieved by this order, because they felt that even without conducting a trial, if he is asking for 350 crores. But he said, prima facie, I have materials and I have the power to do complete justice by using my inherent power under Section 151 CPC. and therefore you will have to pay 350 crores as an interim compensation before we proceed further into the trial. Again, the Union Carbide filed a civil revision petition before the High Court challenging this order of the District Court. And the High Court, which handled this matter, again, I would want to name the judge who delivered such a fantastic... Again, it's very unusual. They said that this judge, Justice Seth, who gave the judgment, he wrote about 110 pages judgment. More on, you know, it's a classical literature. I'll say that it's a classical judgment that anybody would enjoy reading it. Not only for the principles of law involved, but also the reasoning given by the judges by looking into the evolution of the law of tort and all the other things in the United Kingdom. And he gave fantastic reasons. And again, he said that using 151 by District Judge Dio was improper in awarding this compensation. But then he upheld the order of the interim compensation, but reduced it further, which by which reason he became quite unpopular in spite of doing it. He said that, you know, 350 crores is huge for an interim compensation, so he reduced it to 250 crores as the compensation, interim compensation. And again, the matter was referred back to the District Court. But then Union Carbide went on appeal. They filed an SLP before the Supreme Court. They challenged, contested this order. And finally, you know that it all ended up in a settlement where the Supreme Court directed the parties to settle this matter outside the court, and the settlement happened. So the Union Carbide finally agreed for a 470 million US dollars. $470 million, which roughly worked out those days to something around 750 to 800 crores. So this was the final settlement arrived, and then as a result of which they said that all the proceedings will be dropped against Union Carbide because of this final settlement. Then I think people should read the another public interest litigation filed by Charan Lal Sahu challenging this settlement, the validity of this settlement, wherein he said that how can you compound a crime of such magnitude by compensation. Then the Supreme Court realized that, yes, the criminal cases should not have been withdrawn. It should have only withdrawn all the civil cases. But because by oversight, they said withdraw all cases. So in all civil and criminal cases were withdrawn. Now, when in this PIL filed by Charan Lal Sahu, the Supreme Court realized that, it was a mistake. And therefore, it ordered the reopening of all the criminal cases. But then, finally, the Supreme Court had to say that, you know, this is an incident by negligence, and therefore the charges were framed against the employees of Union Carbide Corporation on the grounds on 304 part 2, right, where they were charged for causing death by negligence, where the maximum punishment is 2 years. So finally, the criminal court convicted them in 2010, 26 years later. 2010 was the year where this conviction happened, and the 7 employees were finally convicted. Warren Anderson could not do anything about Warren Anderson. Though he came to India after that incident, but he was asked to leave by the government, and he was kept in a guest house, and then he was sent back safely. So these were all, again, a lot of political and other criticisms involved in this particular matter. Let us not get into politics. We are only looking at the legal developments. So this particular incident, though it had resulted in so many things, In fact, this was one reason why the then Prime Minister thought of coming out with a law to protect our environment from such pollutions. The Environment Protection Act, 1986, was an outcome of this particular incident. So with all these developments, this particular case, Bhopal, has given us a lot of lessons to learn. But though the court said that it is by negligence, but then I could not agree that it's not an act of negligence. Because the Union Carbide knew the effect of methyl isocyanate. They had the knowledge of the impact of this chemical on people. In spite of that, in spite of 61 accidents happening, they have not taken all precautionary measures. It is a culmination of a series of incidents over which the Union Carbide Corporation had knowledge of. I don't know how we can take it as a negligent act. So this is something which I want you guys to listen to it and then, you know, further do some study on it, because this is a case which happened 36 years back. Now you have every information about this particular case. You have all the judgments, the affidavits filed before the New York court, the district judge judgment given by District Judge Dio, the High Court judgment, the Supreme Court judgments, everything is there. But I want some of you to take it up and then connect all this judgment and see that whether we have learnt any lessons. Because still we see that these kind of incidents keep happening. So one thing that what I could say is that lack of information is again a major problem with respect to hazardous industries. When methyl isocyanate leaked, none of the administrators or the doctors, they were not aware. So this kind of lack of information should not be there. I think industries should gear up. They should become more responsible towards environment and towards human life. They can't take the human life for granted. They don't need to wait for an accident to happen. It's high time that they should start engaging with the neighborhood, with the community around. And, you know, they should freely allow community leaders, community, the other, you know, especially they should do training sessions for doctors. They should have a mock drill, safety drills to empower people with the knowledge of how to deal with this situation if there is an accident like this. Like the way, you know, the Disaster Management Authority does drills for earthquakes and other things. So these industries should do some safety drills to ensure that the local community, the immediate neighborhood, people in the immediate neighborhood, they are made aware of what is that industry is dealing with, what are the safety measures, and in case if there is some accident, then what do we do? The doctors in the immediate neighborhood should be trained about this chemical, the hazardous substance, what they are using, and the antidotes to be given. So apart from, you know, complying with all these regulations and a very effective implementation of environmental laws, the industries themselves should volunteer, and they should see that, you know, it's not that of your income into corporate social responsibility and you sponsor some seminar conferences or some other activity. Every company should have a clear-cut environmental responsibilities. It should come out with a policy on corporate environmental responsibility and see that how it could do, not only to take all safety measures to ensure that these kind of incidents doesn't happen, but it should also ensure that the local community is engaged. In fact, they should conduct a tour of the local community people in showing them around the factory so that people around the industries will get some confidence that, okay, these are safety measures there. Even in spite of all these things, if there is an accident, at least people are aware of how they should deal with it. So I think with this, I will conclude for want of time, and maybe for 10 more minutes, I will take some few questions if Nachiketa will permit. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for a wonderful perspective, very detailed, and also telling the students, because I'm sure that some of them who would be in the formative years of law school might not have had the opportunity to read the judgments in detail. And also, as is my experience, all, you know, with all due respect to my students, that they don't follow a lot of news and don't even read the newspapers so thoroughly these days. Yeah. Because I, as a law teacher, I believe that it's very important to read, not just follow the electronic media, but the newspapers too. Because a lot of content that gives that fills the vacuum of understanding the law comes from that particular source, right? Be it criminal law, for that matter of fact, you know, that what is happening to the case. So that there's so much happening in the background, in the backdrop, which gives you a wider perspective to understand the law and its application. So, you know, on that particular note, it's been wonderful to hear from you today that, you know, so much has gone into the entire episode of from the Bhopal to Vizag. And the lessons learned, perhaps, as I understand, have not been adequate in terms of, you know, streamlining that we should have a robust environmental law. And we should have a robust state infrastructure in this particular the field to be in place. As I still see, sir, probably you may agree, that there's a lot of callousness of the state and also the private entities. And probably of the private entities, because the states have not been paying heed to the entire thing. Because had the state law been so robust and taking care of it, I'm sure nobody would have even thought of messing up with it. Right, these things continue because probably they can easily get away with this. Right, from the Bhopal is a classic example of getting away of, you know, Anderson, that how he was brought to, I mean, he came to India, captain. He was almost treated as a state guest, if I'm not wrong, as I remember from the news reports. Mm-hmm. You know, but yeah, because political is an issue in that realm. But be it as it may, so these are the issues, my dear students. If you have any questions, please raise hands and or unmute yourself. You can just keep your questions very brief because of the paucity of time, and then let's take around 5-6 questions if possibly we can. Yeah, so anybody who wants to go ahead with the question, you can raise hand and I can then follow it up. I can see, yeah, Shubham, go ahead.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, Shubham.
Very good morning, sir.
Good morning, Shubham.
Sir, my question is, sir, in the Vizag case, the NGT has used the strict liability doctrine. Yeah, but correct. But the PN Bhagwati has established the doctrine of the absolute liability. Then correct. What is the reason for using this? And the PN Bhagwati give the very strong grounds to using absolute liability.
Correct. Yeah, in fact, the law is very well settled, Shubham, because if as far as hazardous industries are concerned, now there is no choice available for the courts to decide what kind of liability. As far as the hazardous industries are concerned, the only law that is applicable to them is the absolute liability principle, declared by the Supreme Court, Justice K. N. Bhagwati, through Justice K. N. Bhagwati in Shriram Foods and Fertilizers Company's oleum gas leak case. So it's very well settled. In fact, people are not clear. You know, you see that there is a lot of debate happening why the NGT had to refer to an age-old strict liability theory, which supports a lot of exceptions. We're not sure because we are not clear as to why the NGT had used, what are the circumstances which compelled NGT to prefer the use of the word strict liability. Or maybe, you know, while talking about strict liability, maybe that they might have had absolute liability in mind, because, the for example, the Public Liability Insurance Act, it doesn't use the word absolute liability. It uses the word no-fault liability. Right. So likewise, you know, we really do not know. We'll have to wait and see that what we'll have to see why NGT had used this expression strict liability. But I'm sure that strict liability is not is no more relevant in India because of the nature of the industry is concerned, and especially by virtue of the judgment given by the Supreme Court in MCMA.
Right. Krishna, you wanted to go next?
Good morning, sir. My question is, in most of the MNCs, the foreign entity is the one who possesses the control. Yeah. So now in a case like this, so the foreign entity should be punished or the Indian authorities?
No, see, it's an Indian company. No? So whoever may be, for example, same, if you look at the Union Carbide India Limited, it was only 50.8% of the shares were held by the Union Carbide Corporation US. Remaining, 49.1% share was owned by Government of India companies, including big banks and the Government of India. Right? But still, we tried to hold UCC liable, but then you know the judgments there, where they clearly made that you have a company incorporated in India and therefore they should be held responsible. Of course, you read the judgment of the district judge Dio, who went to the extent of lifting the corporate veil, which generally at the district courts, they don't do that. So that's why I said it's a very landmark judgment from at the district court level. So when they have an entity incorporated under the Indian law, why do we even need to go behind a foreign company? I don't see any rhyme or reason there.
Right. Sukanya, you wanted to ask something? Sukanya? Okay. Indira Devi, then you can go ahead.
Good morning, sir. My question is about the criminal liability that you have mentioned in the lecture. So if not for death by negligence, what is the other recourse that could have been taken with respect to criminal liability? Is it more of culpable homicide, or is there anything else that could have been added for the criminal liability aspect of it?
Personally speaking, in looking into the facts and the circumstances which had led to the Bhopal gas leaks disaster, it's a culpable homicide. My personal opinion is that. Because they knew the consequences. They were completely having knowledge of everything. So this should squarely fall in the definition of culpable homicide, not amounting to.
Right. Preeti, Sivaraman, you want to ask something that you have put in the chat box. Do you want to ask yourself?
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
So, considering that the LG Polymers has a parent company in South Korea, will this call cause similar problems like it caused in Bhopal gas tragedy, like prolonged litigation?
That's what, what we have learned from our experience in UAR. I think we should not go behind the parent company. The company is incorporated in India, and therefore we should go as per our own laws. And I think our courts have now learned the lesson what they had to do. In fact, another very important part of the judgment given by Judge Dio at the District Court of Bhopal was that one of the points that raised was there was no precedent for handling these things. He said that we can't wait for somebody else to create precedent. We will create precedent. But here you have a precedent now. And that was the reason why even NGT immediately ordered this 50 crores compensation to be paid. Again, there are legal views that I got to know from unofficial circles that LG's lawyers are trying to move the Supreme Court to get a stay against the order of the NGT because according to them, they were not heard even before passing this order of 50 crores. So this is going to go to the Supreme Court and come back to NGT, and you will see a lot of legal battles happening.
All right. Suditi, do you have a question? Go ahead.
Good morning, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, Suditi, audible.
Sir, I wanted to ask that Article 21 gives us the guarantee of right to life. And when such incidences happen in the IT industry, people are deprived of that. So how do we read Article 21 in consonance with the gas leak incidents in the IT industry?
See, it is unfortunate that, you know, most of the environmental jurisprudence in this country has its root to Article 21. Article 21 was not made for this purpose originally, right? But then since the courts found themselves in a helpless situation wherein they have very weak environmental legislations where they could not come out with any effective remedies, courts had to provide remedies. So they molded remedies and they used 21 and 32 to do all this environmental justice. For example, you know, I do not know how many of you have gone through this case by Mohan Meakins. When Mohan Meakins is a big distillery unit, when they were polluting River Ganga in the distillery unit in Kanpur, the Pollution Control Board took some samples and they tried to prosecute under the Water Act for polluting the river water. Believe me, it took 20 years. They went so many times up and down to the Supreme Court. And finally, after 20 years, Supreme Court said, no, the magistrate has jurisdiction. Now he can try this case. After 20 years, the samples have evaporated. How to prosecute them? You know, so that is where, you know, people feel helpless. And therefore, they try and approach the High Court and Supreme Court under 226 and 32 respectively. Otherwise, you know, the environmental laws have remedies if at all, you know. You see, you don't need to go to the court. The Pollution Control Board authorities have the power to close down these industries. But these authorities do not use that power. They will not go and close that industries. They will, you know, compel you and me to go to the High Court, get a direction, and under that direction, they will go and close. Ultimately, the High Court or the Supreme Court will direct the Pollution Control Board to order closure. The Pollution Control Board itself has the power to order the closure. But then the Pollution Control Board would not want to do this. And they would want people to struggle. And, you know, if people go to the streets, what will happen? Thoothukudi is the best example. Against the Sterlite Industries, people protested and, you know, people were killed. 12 of them were shot dead on their head. So these are, you know, this is what is what I wanted to say as lessons unlearned. Because we want again a direction from the Supreme Court for everything. And if Supreme Court is approached under 2132, I don't see that there is no relief for this country.
Right. So we'll take probably just one last question. I know you have to.
Yeah, I have to leave.
Meetings. Pranisha, you can ask your question. Pranisha, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Pranisha.
Yes, sir. My question to you is that since such crimes have been increasing day by day and we see that such incidents are... Am I audible?
Pranisha, the first part of your question I
could not... Yes, sir. Sir, what I wanted to ask is that since such crimes are yet prevalent in our society, so what guidelines should do you feel that we should be formulating so to prevent such crimes in near future?
Pranisha, honestly speaking, we have plenty of rules and regulations. Enough of it. What we need is, you know, a very effective executive machinery to enforce these legislations. I have known cases where the officers themselves had approached the High Court for and filed a PIL. I know in Gujarat it happened, you know, an officer of the Pollution Control Board went to the High Court. And he said that he filed a PIL to order the closure of an industry. The judge asked him, like, you are the officer of the Pollution Control Board. You have ample power under the Act. Why don't you close it? Why are you coming to the High Court to ask for a direction? And he said that, no, you should go and close it. But then, you know, there are so many other factors as well. You know, I don't need to discuss it on a public platform. You know the reasons why these officers do not act, react, take any actions. So those are, you know, basic things which we need to change, Pranisha. It's not that, you know, we don't have laws. We have adequate laws. We have sufficient laws. We have very effective laws, rather, better than many other countries.
Right.
what is lacking is a very effective enforcement in the interest of the common man.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir, for this interesting lecture and also giving us a very wider perspective to think just beyond the statutory provisions and how we can, you know, do our research in fact better, and also some of the law students who want to look at it from the law of torts perspective, somebody who want to probably do some kind of empirical work in this, and right. you know, take this entire kind of study further. So on that note, and I must tell everybody in the audience today that sir has been, you know, one of the first vice chancellors of NLU's that who has come forward to support the virtual law school and my this kind of initiative of a law teacher. So for that also, sir, I really want to thank you.
Thank you,
sir. And also we have been blessed as a virtual law school that with the support of some of the senior retired judges of the Supreme Court, Justice A.K. Sikri, Justice Kurian Joseph, some of the senior counsels of the Supreme Court, Mr. Siddharth Luthra, also, you know, Mr. Rajiv Luthra from Luthra and Luthra, which is now LNL Partners. And we have also, you know, been getting support from various judges. In fact, one of the sitting judges of the High Court of Madhya Pradesh is teaching full course on Code of Criminal Procedure. And some of the, you know, senior professors, I can see Professor Yogesh Pratap Singh, the registrar of NLU, Odisha has also joined in. And also thank you, Professor Arthur, Professor Archana, for joining in today and all the students. So we will be taking forward the global legal approach and development talk series forward. And to tell everybody in the audience, in the next 2 weeks, we have lined up some very eminent speakers, you know, also from the bar, like Dr. Abhishek Singhvi, who will be speaking on collaborative federalism. And then later this week, we will also have a senior advocate, Mr. Kapil Sibal, joining us on Saturday. And also Justice Yatindra Singh, who is a former Chief Justice of Chhattisgarh High Court, joining us on a wonderful, you know, area, little different from the regular issues of law, on something called as overcoming glossophobia, the fear of public speaking. So we are going to bring to you a lot of these kinds of lectures for everybody, not just the students of Virtual Law School, but all the law students of the country and, you know, lawyers and legal academia. So thank you once again, sir, for joining thank us you, today, for giving you. Us the inaugural lecture for the GLAD Talk series. Thank you, everyone, for joining us.
Thanks to you. Thank you so much. Thank you.